We're going to have just a wonderful day of worship ahead of us. Before we get started, I did want to welcome Kent back. A week ago, we were praying for Kent. He's back today. Kent, Cindy can give you one of these. We're going to give you one of these. That's Christian love. That's a part of the church thing, okay? We're glad you're here. I do want to remind everybody, please take the time to fill out the tab on your bulletin. Tear that off. Let us know if you have any praise or prayer requests. And we want to share in that as a church family. And then just put that in the offering plate when it comes around a little bit later on. Also, we do practice open communion here in Southwest, so if you are a baptized believer that Jesus Christ is the Son of the living God, then we invite you to take part in that communion service a little bit later on. Why don't we just open with a word of prayer. Jesus, we thank you. We thank you for this Resurrection Sunday. And thank you, Jesus, for going to that cross. And we thank you, Jesus, for giving us the greatest gift that could ever be given, the promise of salvation. Help us to live our lives, Jesus, just to be pleasing to you, to walk in the path that would be pleasing to you. And help us, Jesus, to spread your word of your kingdom to others. Lord, our prayer today is that hearts are touched and lives are changed, and that your kingdom is glorified here in this church, here in Mount Vernon, and across the world. We just give you all praise, and honor, and glory. Amen.
Amen.
I think our little ones have a home for us this morning, so I want them to come on up and do that now. His appearance was like lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him, they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the women, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He has risen. Just as he said, come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell the disciples, he has risen from the dead, and he is going ahead of you to Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. And when they saw him, they worshipped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely, I am with you always, to the very end of the age." Won't you stand and lift your voices and praise his name?
Yourself and carry the wrong.
don't you get, turn around and give somebody one of those.
Thank you. many of you here, but Jesus is the name that is above every other name. And it's the power of the name of Jesus Christ that we gather here together. It's the power of his name that we say these prayers. I want to remind you of something real quick. I am not a good enough man to go to heaven. You guys all realize that, right?
No.
And I know some of you may be sitting here today thinking, oh golly, if the preacher ain't good enough to go to heaven, then I'm in trouble. But I think probably most of you understand what I'm saying. I am not a good enough man to go to heaven, but I have a Savior. Good people don't go to heaven. Saved people go to heaven. And that salvation comes through the power of Jesus Christ, and that's why we gather here this morning to celebrate. For us that are in Christ already, we celebrate the resurrection every single day of our life. I'm thrilled to be celebrating it as a corporate group today, but we rejoice in the name of Jesus. I'm up here to say the prayer. So I do want you to look at your prayer request in the bulletin real quick. It's this little gray sheet of paper.
You're right.
I have a few things written down. And also, if you have to fill out the registration cards that are attached in your bulletin, make sure to do that. On the back side of the section to fill out any prayers, anything that's on your heart, anything that you're having troubles or tribulation with that you want us to pray over every single day, I can guarantee you that will happen. So make sure to fill those out and drop them in the offering plate later. In the prayers, we have a number of things written down. First of all, the awareness of what we're here for today, that we are here in the name of Jesus Christ, your Savior. Second was just to keep in prayer the victims there at the Brussels, Belgium attacks. This last week, with the fire at Garden Glen, just a miracle that took place there of the people's lives, that no one was hurt in the midst of that. And I want you to keep in prayer all those that were involved in. Also, I want you to keep James in prayer as he sits in a cell. And, you know, I pray for openness of his mind and heart in the midst of that. He's actually relations to some of our former family here, and we want to keep him in prayer as well. Also want to keep in prayer Mary Dalton. She had her ankle surgery and is recovering at Centralia Manor. Jeff Reed, April 1st, will be quitting his full-time job and full-time into the mission field in Tanzania. And I know Dale announced that last week, but we are joining forces with him to become a link between Tanzania and Southwest Christian Church. And I know that plans for me is, and for me and hopefully some of you here, is that we'll be going back and forth between there to do that work, especially with children and a new church plant in Bogla? It's a Morgora area.
Morgora,
that's what the city is. Bigla or something like that.
Hopefully. It's going to get real, Ben, and our support of missionaries. It's coming.
It's going to get real, real fast. So, all right. And then also just to continue to pray for restorations of our families and the community and our family. I believe in a powerful Savior. I believe that he does not let our prayers go void. I believe that he can accomplish all things. And you're going to hear a lot of that today in the sermon. I believe in Jesus Christ. And whether I'm the last man standing or not in this community, and which I know will not be the case with all of you here, but we are to claim Jesus Christ with every single ounce of effort we have. And that's what we're doing here this morning. So if you'll bow your heads and pray with me. Lord God Almighty, it is in the power of your most holy name, Jesus Christ, that we ask and pray these things. God, as we join here this day, we celebrate your resurrection, your victory over death. Because of that victory, we know we have hope. No matter what sins, no matter what troubles, no matter what tribulation we face, we know that you are the Savior of the world, but more importantly than that, you are the Savior of me and each of us personally. Lord, I pray for open eyes, ears, and hearts to that message today, that we would realize what this is all about. God, I do lift up to you each of these situations for our family, for our brothers and sisters in Brussels. I pray for healing, restoration there. But Lord, there are so many of these attacks taking place throughout the world that we never hear about. I pray for the Christians. I pray for those that stand against the forces of evil in this world. Lord, help them, strengthen them. Lord, I thank you so much for saving the lives of so many people down here in Garden Glen. And for seeing them through, I thank you for the provisions and for the way the community has drawn together to help. Lord, I lift it to you, James, today. I pray that his eyes and heart would be open, that he would see things clearly, and that he would continue to seek you and lean on you. Lord, I lift it to you, Mary Gothic, today. I pray healing in her ankle, and I pray for just peace on her as she's away from us. And I pray that you would see her through. Lord, I lift it to you, Jeff Reed. I pray that you would just enable, strengthen, and give him the provisions to get over to Tanzania as soon as possible. And I pray for us in the midst of that, that we would work hard to continue to see that happen. And Lord, I do lift up to you just our families throughout this community, throughout this nation, throughout the state, and throughout our church family. Strengthen us. Help us to stand for you, to seek your guidance, to seek your healing, to seek your restoration. Lord, we just want to give you praise and glory. I just ask that you would touch each of us here this day to open our eyes, to pour out everything we have in the lifting of your name here this morning. It's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Made straight up, I made. today we are celebrating Jesus is birthday, or Jesus is risen. It's rising, I should say. And in turn, because of that, I want to welcome each and every one of you to Southwest Christian Church. We practice, as we have said before, open communion. And if you have surrendered your life to Jesus Christ and would like to partake in the ceremony, we would like for that to happen. You could take it immediately, or you could wait on it and take it a little bit later. But today, the sermon that I have prepared, or the communion that I have prepared, it comes directly from our Bible, and it talks about Jesus Christ's death, burial, and resurrection. And it is from 1 Corinthians chapter 15, 1 through 19. And it states, "Moreover, brethren, I declare that the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received, in which you stand, by which also you are saved, if you hold fast that word which I preached to you, unless you believe in vain, or is in vain. For I delivered you first of all that which I have received, that Christ died for our sins, according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and then he rose on the third day, as the scriptures state. And that he was seen by Cephas and the 12 others, after he was seen by over 500 people, by 500 brethren, at once whom the greater part remained to the present, but have fallen asleep. After that he was seen by James." We all say,
Amen. Thank you.
God, we thank you for this beautiful creation. Thank you for sending your son, Jesus, that we might be redeemed and be restored. God, as we bring our gifts and our offerings and our tithes before you, we just pray, Lord, that you would use them in a great and mighty way, just to grow your kingdom here in this church and in this city and across the world. God, we give you all praise, honor, and glory for your blessings upon the gift and giver. Amen. Thank you.
should I tuck the shirt in all the way or pull it out a little bit? Does it make my belly look bigger? I think it's my belly that makes it look bigger. You know, so often, and I brought the mirror up here just for a little bit of effect. We look at mirrors every single day of our life. Anybody not ever look at the mirror? If you don't, you're probably saying, I don't shower, and you don't raise your hand. But what I'm saying is we look in mirrors every day, but sometimes, and I know probably every single person here has done it at one point, you look in that mirror and you look at yourself and you go, who am I? How did I get in this mess? How did I get to this point? How did I ever do that? How did I say that? How did I ever turn my back? What's happened to my faith? Where have I come? You know, we look at all these things and we look in mirrors and we see ourselves for who we are. You know, I don't look in the mirror and I don't see someone else. I see me. And when you look in the mirror, you see yourself. So I want you to kind of picture that in your mind today. I want you to reflect on yourself today. Whoever you came with, however you ended up here at Southwest today, I don't care. I'm just glad you're here, and I want you to reflect on you personally and your relationship with the Almighty Savior that has risen up today. Will you bow your head to me? Lord God, as we come before you today, we come as men and women that want to be open and receptive to who you are. We don't come with fancy words or presentation. We come in the power of your name, Almighty Savior Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray and ask you to move in this house, to change myself and to change each of these men and women, that we would be filled with the power of your Holy Spirit, that we would long and just be filled with who you are, to be filled with your word and to be filled with your presence. Lord, I just thank you for each of these men and women. I ask your blessing on them here and now as we study. Holy Spirit, do what you wish. It's in your name, Jesus, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
So as we look at this today, the resurrection, it's a word that I stop and think a lot about. I hope that if you have been a Christian more than a day, that at some point in your life you have stopped and thought about that word as well. What does the resurrection mean? Literally, we read in the scriptures, it's the rebirth of Jesus Christ, the return of him from the grave, of him overcoming death, literally dying on the cross, taking the keys of life and death and hell and returning it victorious for you and I. You heard me say it earlier, you're going to see it here in a few minutes again in the sermon. Good people don't go to heaven. Saved people go to heaven. Now, saved people should look good and should be good in the picture of things, but that's not what saves us. Jesus Christ is the one who saves. And you're going to see this statement reiterate throughout the message this morning. The resurrection, Jesus Christ, is everything to me. I'm willing to give it all up. I'm willing to give up my house. I'm willing to give up my family. I'm willing to give up my life. Because Jesus Christ in the resurrection is everything to me. It amazes me. You know, to me, I look at life, I look at the animals, I look at creation, and all of it screams out that there's God. But yet, I talk to friends, I talk to neighbors, I talk to people on Facebook, and so many people cannot see. The scripture describes that those that our eyes are blinded will not be able to see, and those that love the Lord Jesus Christ will see. We're going to have some of that spelled out to us here today. Now, as we look in the mirror, James 1:19-27 says, my dear brothers, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, for man's anger does not bring about the righteous life that God desires. Boy, I tell you, and you guys probably realize it real quickly, there is so much anger in our culture today, and it's because, and I'm not trying to be mean to any of you here today, but we have become a very selfish people. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and all the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Have all of you here in this house Have you been in church before? Is anybody, this is your absolutely first time to step foot in a church building? If you've been in church, if you've ever grown up with church, if you have ever been in the presence of a church, then accept what's been planted in you. Don't walk away today with just hearing the word, but take it, that which can save you. Verse 22, if you're not merely to listen to the word and so to deceive yourself, do what it said. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like a man who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away immediately and forgets what he looks like. Sometimes I kind of wish I could, but we remember what we look like. But the man who looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues to do this, not forgetting what he has heard, but doing it, he will be blessed in what he does. If anyone considers himself religious and yet does not keep a tight rein on his tongue, he deceives himself and his religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look at orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. All right, so I asked you at the very beginning, I don't care how you ended up in these pews today. I don't care who brought you. All I care about is you're here. And I ask you, I want you to reflect on you personally between you and God and Jesus Christ. A couple of measures that was given here in the scriptures. One, if we've grown up in this stuff, if we've heard the truth, if we've seen the Bible, if we've had Jesus Christ talk to us, then accept that which has been planted in us. Some of you here today, you may have never accepted it. You may think you have, but until you surrender everything, you have not. A lot of times we walk around in that false sense of hope that we really haven't taken in. The Bible said, it described it here in the Word. How do we measure if we're in the faith? How do we measure if we're in that relationship? How do we measure if we're in Jesus Christ? Well, it's going to show. And it's going to show by the man I see in this mirror. I'm not going to be the same guy that I used to be. I'm not going to be filled with shame and guilt and all those things because I have been saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. My mouth, my heart, my life, my actions, my resources, my finances, everything about me is going to change and I am going to give it to the Savior Jesus Christ. Why? Because He's everything. He's everything to me. It's not about a religion. Here in this last verses, it said, if we can't keep a tight rein on our tongue, our religion is worthless. Anybody got mouth issues? Some of you got deep orbit? Some of that gum is sticking in your mouth, cleaned up? No, what we need is Jesus Christ. And I have to tell you, when I, as a senior in high school, gave my life to Jesus Christ, and if my, any of my family's in here, close your ears for a moment. But as a senior in high school, my language, my adjectives that I used were very colorful, especially when I played basketball. I was very intent about basketball. And so when I was on the court, there were many things that came out of me that I would never say in a church building. Do you know what I've come to find out as I've grown in my faith and I've accepted Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior? I am the church building. I am the church. Everywhere I go, Jesus Christ is with me. One of the quick measures for me when I first became a Christian was that I had to get a tight rein on my tongue. That was the very first thing I worked on. But you know what? It happened. You know how it happened? Because Jesus was working from the inside out. I couldn't do it on my own. Literally, I think today, somebody get a hammer, I can smash my thumb, I'm not going to cuss. You guys want to try it? You'd love to see that illustration, wouldn't you? I'm not doing it. Look at this next part. For us in this, we bank everything on this truth. Andy stood up here during the communion meditation and read these scriptures from 1 Corinthians 15. I want to highlight a couple of those verses he said. He said, now brothers, I want to remind you of the gospel I preached to you, which you received and on which you have taken your stand. By this gospel, you are saved if you hold firmly to the word I preached to you. Otherwise, you have believed in vain. What is the basis of us being in this house? If I have nice you dressed today, if I have much money you put in the offering plate, by the way you sung the songs today, by how good this week you've done of not saying a cuss word, by what you've watched this week, by the things you participated in. No, the condition, what saves, is Jesus Christ. Man, there's something powerful about that name. You know what it is? It's no secret. He is the Savior of the world. He is the Savior of all mankind. He is the Savior of this preacher. So I tell you once again, this preacher is not good enough to go to heaven. But this preacher will go to heaven because he has a Savior.
Amen.
And that Savior is making me good. Not only that, his condition is not just to make you good. His condition is to make you whole. So I've asked this question many a time from this pulpit. But on a scale from 1 to 10, how righteous are you people here this day? All right, so we get this different range. Some of you remember the question. But so often we answer that question, we look in our mirror, and we look at ourselves, and we go, how righteous of a man am I? How good of a man am I? And so a lot of times we tend to be humble in that. We'd say, maybe a 1, maybe a 2. If you're really feeling good about yourself, you may say a 5 or a 6. But when I ask on that same question, on the scale of 1 to 10, how righteous is Jesus Christ, what's the answer?
Oh,
he's perfect. He's a 10. There's no question here. So, back to the first question. On a scale of 1 to 10, realizing I'm not measuring by how good of a man I am, although Jesus makes me good, I measure it on the righteousness that Jesus Christ has established in me, saving my very soul, saving my very hide, saving my life from the flames of eternal hell. How righteous of a man am I in Jesus? 10. And my friends, that's where the big disconnect comes from. That's where we struggle so much in this life. That's why we have so many problems day in, day out, because we forget who we belong to, and whose we are. When you ask a man or a woman in Jesus Christ who they are or what they do, they should say, I am a Christian. Not Randy Steele, not preacher, not father, not husband, not teacher, Christian. And what does that mean? I'm a man, just like any other man in this room, or any other woman in this room, that is saved by the blood of Jesus Christ. It is this gospel that saves us. Jumping down to verse 17. And if Christ has not been raised from the dead, your faith is futile. You are still in your sins. Then those also who have fallen asleep in Christ are lost. If only for this life we have hope in Christ, we are to be pitied more than all men. Do you catch the extent of what that says? You know, my wife says a lot of times, you say things so extreme. Do you realize God's word is extreme? Do you realize if we converted the Bible into a movie that it would probably be rated R? The Bible is extreme. The Bible is real. It doesn't try to sugarcoat life. It shows people in real situations, and it says it the way it is. And for you and I here in this house today, if we come here on this Resurrection Sunday and Jesus Christ is not raised from the dead, we are wasting our time. This is nothing more than a social gathering, a place for us to come feel good about ourselves if Jesus Christ not be raised. But praise be to God. You and I, we are here today for no other reason but to understand that He has indeed raised from the dead. Amen. Let's hear that Baptist. Come on.
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Jumping on down. We just heard this in the song. Death has been swallowed up in victory. Where, O death, is your victory? Where, O death, is your sting? The sting of death is sin, and the power of sin is the law. But thanks be to God, He gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, my dear brothers, stand firm. Let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain. And when we read down through that, so often we hear it in funeral services. But this is talking about life. You catch the last part of what it says? Don't live your life in vain. If Jesus Christ not be raised from the dead, then we're the fools. But if he is raised from the dead, then every one of us should never live life the same again. Everything changes. You know, we're going to look at some pretty extreme statements here. The first, you've already heard, good people do not go to heaven. Saved people do. You have to understand that in this house today. If you don't get that, then you got to ask yourself some questions. I'm talking about self-reflection. I'm talking about looking in the mirror. I'm talking about asking yourself, am I saved? Have I surrendered my life? Is everything I'm about Jesus Christ? Now, the true cost of freedom, we find this in John chapter 8, verse 31 through 32. Jesus here speaking says to the Jews who have believed in him, if you hold to my teachings, you really are my disciple. This next verse is one we hear so often. It goes on to say, then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. What is this truth? It's the same thing we read in James. If you grew up in the Bible, if you grew up in church, you've had this seed planted. But have you surrendered to that? I can stand up here today, I can read you sections of the Bible, I want to read you scriptures, I believe that the Bible preaches itself. We can learn that truth. But it's so much greater. Jesus Christ, when he came into this world, he said, I did not come to abolish the law or the truth or the scripture. I came to fulfill it. So when we read a passage like this, we're not just talking about some book. We're not just talking about learning that book. We're not just talking about correct teaching of the Bible, although that's great stuff. We are talking about more than a religion. We're talking about a relationship. We're talking about one that lives in us. We're talking about never being alone again. We're talking about being able to pray at any time of the day or night. Jesus Christ is there. We're talking about one who is always there, no matter where you lay, no matter what you've done, no matter where you go, Jesus Christ is there. That's what this is talking about. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free, and that truth is Jesus Christ. But the cost of that freedom comes at a great price. And it's because of my words, it's because of my actions, it's because of the guy I see in this mirror that he died on the cross. Not because of you people. Now in turn, you should be saying the same thing right back to me. It's because of me, not you Randy, because of me that Jesus died on that cross. Until it becomes about me, this is futile. I hope you grasp that today. Until it becomes about you sitting there, you participating in this service, it's futile. And we're going to look at some of this as we go on. Anybody ever seen this symbol before? Kind of a cool symbol. Big U with a dot above it. Literally what that symbol is, it's a symbol from the Arabic language that is the equivalent of our letter N in our alphabet. This is a symbol that ISIS has been painting on houses throughout Iraq, Pakistan, throughout the world. Mosul, I know that this has been painted many times. And what that symbol literally represents is Nazarene. And what it means is this. If they paint that on your house, you no longer have a house. If they paint that on your house, that means you're still in it, you're going to be killed. That means you're going to be thrown out. That means you're going to take all your stuff. That means your car's out in the lot. They're going to take it. Everything. Gone. If that be painted on your house. That symbol. It means that they are a follower of Jesus Christ. Now, one of the things Scripture teaches us is this is an all or nothing proposition. And the reason I put that symbol up there today is because I have been reading through one of the Voice of the Martyr books. Literally, all this book is a book of Christian men and women that have paid it all to remain in their faith. You know, I hear so often people saying, well, you know, Sunday was real busy, and I was real tired, I was out late. Randy, you don't understand, I just couldn't find a thing to wear. Randy, you know, I mean, I would have had to walk 2 blocks. You kidding me? You want me to go to church like that? And I read these stories. And it kills me.
Because I live in a society that is so selfish, that is so full of ourselves, that is so consumed with materialism, so caught up in the things of the world that we don't even see it. These people would die because of their faith in Jesus Christ. And I ask myself the question, and I hope each of you in this house asks the same question, what am I missing? What don't I get? Why am I more concerned about a retirement plan than I am about saving my brothers and sisters in other parts of the world? Why is it that I'm so worried about my own safety that I don't get on a plane and go save some of these folks? My friends, the cost of discipleship is everything. Jesus literally asked, before you and I give our lives to Him, that we ask ourselves, what is the cost of the discipleship? Do you realize there are thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people surrendering their life to Jesus Christ every day in that area of the world? And when they do it, do you realize it's a statement of theirs, I'm willing to give it all up. So how many of you today, if I said, hey, listen, it may cost you everything. Matter of fact, if you come to Jesus Christ, you confess Him here today, you can't leave with your car. Well, what are you talking about, preacher? You keep Jesus, I'll take my car. You know, I've been thinking to myself, what would it take in this culture in Mount Vernon to get people to just swarm the church? And so I thought about, literally thought about, and I haven't passed this by the board yet, so might be a thing to pray about, of offering a $100 giveaway every single week to anyone that attends church for the first time. Anybody first time visitor, Nick? $100 a week. Because what does a soul cost? What is it worth? Jesus tells us that the cost of discipleship is everything. But until we get that, we see nothing. Luke 14, 25 through 35, large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, He said, if anyone comes to Me and does not hate his father and mother, his wife and children, his brothers and sisters, yes, even his own life, he cannot be My disciple. The clarifier in that statement is yes, not even his own life. You realize Jesus ain't telling you, start talking back to your mom and dad. You need to hate that people around you. That's not what He's saying. He's saying, until I am everything to you, you won't know how to be a father or mother. Until I'm everything to you, you won't know how to be a parent or a spouse. You won't know how to be everything that God has called you to be until you surrender everything to Me. And anyone who did not carry his cross and follow Me cannot be My disciple. Verse 27, what is Jesus telling us? What is the cross? Oh, it's beautiful jewelry that we wear. It's something we hang around our neck. What was it in that time? Pick up your instrument of death and carry it with you everywhere you go. Wow, that sounds great. That's what Jesus was saying. The sacrifice that comes in knowing who the Savior of the world is. Verse 28, suppose one of you wants to build a tower. Will he not first sit down and estimate the cost to see if he has enough money to complete it? Or if he lays a foundation and is not able to finish it, everyone who sees it will ridicule him, saying, this fellow began to build and was not able to finish. Or suppose a king goes to war against another king. Will he not first sit down and consider whether he is able with 10,000 men to oppose the one coming against him with 20,000? If he is not able, he will send a delegation while the other is still a long way off and will ask for terms of peace. In the same way, any of you, in the same way, any of you, in the same way, any of us who does not give up everything he has, cannot be My disciples. Salt is good, but if it loses its saltiness, how can it be made salty again? It is fit neither for the soil nor for the manure pile or the poo-poo pile. It is thrown out. It is worthless. It has no purpose. And the cost of discipleship is My life. Now I know that when you come to a resurrection, or as the world wants to say, an Easter service, this is not what you want to hear. But you do realize when we come to a resurrection service, we are talking about a man, the Son of God, the one that was perfect, the one that was eternal, the one that gave up heaven came and died for us, giving it all for love. You want to know what love is? It's not getting all super excited about the way somebody looks. It's not getting all excited and feelings wrapped up. It's about sacrifice, mercy, and grace. It's about being willing to die. I loved how it was said in our marriage enrichment last weekend. The guy that was standing up there, he said literally this: until you die, you will never have a good marriage. And what he was saying was simply this: until you die to self, we cannot have a good marriage. We cannot have a good parenting relationship. We cannot understand what it is to be truly human. Again, side note, I will never hear anybody else in this church at whatever again say, well, I'm only human. That's hogwash. Humans have been created in the image of the Almighty God. Even the angels of heaven are jealous of you because you have been created in the image of the Almighty God. Stop thinking that you're worthless. Stop thinking that you're not worthy. Stop thinking that you're only human and start believing in the one who has saved you and brought you and paid the price to make you what you are, a beautiful creation of God. Now, this is a statement we're going to kind of wrap up on here today. Until Christ is everything to me, Christ will be nothing to me. Until Christ is everything to me, Randy, he will be nothing to me. And I hope you're grasping that today. I hope you're counting the cost of discipleship. Do you understand? When I talk about these other men and women, these are our brothers and sisters in Christ. They give it all. I'm asking you today to give it all. But in return, you will get everything. Eternal life. Now, I'm not going to run down here and do it, but a lot of you have seen it before. A lot of times I'll take a pen and draw a little mark on the wall. And I never can spot the mark on the wall. I always try to do it in the same spot. Anybody see it, David? Can you see it? All right. Still can't see the mark on the wall, but there's a little dot on the wall over here. If that dot represented our lives and our time here on earth, and the rest of eternity was the expansion of this room, what would you focus the most attention to? The dot? That minimal little piece of time? Or would you be more concerned about the eternity? Satan has done a very good job. We have allowed him to do a very good job of making us concerned about the dot. Until Christ is everything to me, Christ will be nothing to me. I know that's an extreme statement, but I want to get across to you what it's all about. This is the last statement. It's at the bottom of your bulletins. And this is the question, and you don't have to show anybody else. But I want you to fill in one of these two lines. That means your own personal name. It could be a nickname if you want. God knows what your nickname is. But on one of those lines, either write, will I, Randy Steele, rise, or I, Randy Steele, will rise. Go ahead. I'm going to give you a moment. If you don't have a pen or something, just bite your finger and write in blood. Carve somebody, or eventually put it down. I can use this all day. Get her done. All right. If you haven't got it written down mentally, hopefully you've gotten it down. But today, two different marks. Will I, Randy, still rise? If I make a statement like that, what am I saying? Really, what the statement goes back to when I say, will I, Randy, still rise? I'm saying, cussing enough. You know, do I say enough nice stuff out of my mouth? Do I give enough money in the church offering? Do I do enough things to help people? Am I generally a pretty nice guy? Because you don't want to see me angry. Am I a pretty decent fella? That's what I'm asking if I say, will I rise? It is my prayer, and it's what I'm going to pray here before we get out of this house today. That you will, if you haven't already signed it, will change your name to the bottom line.
I, Randy Steele, will rise. I am 100% confident I will spend eternity in heaven. I have no qualms about my past. I have sin in me just like everybody else. There's been things I've said, things I've done, all that. But I want to be a genuine man of God. I know that my salvation is dependent not on who I am, but on my Savior, Jesus Christ. I have counted the cost of discipleship, and I am willing to lay it all down. And I have no qualms in telling you here this after today, that means everything. Everything. I want you to think about it seriously today. I don't care who's sitting by you. I don't care how you came here today. I want you to think about it. Apart from everyone else, I want you to go in your own little place and think about it. Will I rise? Yes, I will. I want you to have that determination. I want you to have that confidence. But that confidence that is in Jesus Christ. And will you bow your head to me? Lord God, Almighty, the most powerful, awesome, amazing, holy, righteous, loving one. You are God Almighty. You are Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. You are our Holy Spirit, our guide, our counselor. Lord, we measure today the cost of discipleship. We ask ourselves personally, am I willing to pay the price? Lord, I pray right now that you would open our eyes and hearts to surrender everything that we have, all of our hopes, all of our desires, all of our stuff, everything to your will, to your way. Lord, we know you're worth it. Your love is amazing. You are the one that makes us holy. You are the one that makes us righteous. You are the only one. You are the only one that is over. Come, death. You hold the keys, and I want to be a part of your team. So I surrender myself to you. I pray that same thing for each of us in this house today. By the power of your name, most holy Savior, Jesus Christ, we ask and pray these things. Would you please stand as our praise team comes to you?
Time this morning, I painted a little image for you. And as we sing this song, I'd like the words just to flow through you. And that means closing your eyes or whatever you feel comfortable with, you do that. I'd like that image to be one of Jesus standing here right now. And he's standing here with his arms flexed and his palms up. And he's ready to receive us. You know, in the last couple of weeks, Dave was hit by a car last weekend. His heart was stopping. We never know what the next hour will bring. Praise God, they're here in healing. We never know the next minute, the next hour will bring. And there's no guarantees for tomorrow, save one. Jesus is our salvation. So, as we sing this song, you let these words flow through you and you picture the image. If you'd like to come down here and pray, just lay your burdens. If there's a burden on your heart today and you want to come down here and pray, you do that. People will come and pray for you and with you. And if you want to place your membership here today, you can do that too. Just step forward. If you want to be baptized today, the baptism is right here behind us and the towels and the robes are here. And Jesus is standing. Thank you.
with us, but as I said, this is a celebration we commit to every day of our lives as Christians. I want you to think real quick as you head out of this house today, is there something more? Is there something more to life? And when you read in the scriptures, you read of the Savior, you read of God, you read of His power, you read of His glory, you read of His creation, you read of all the miracles and the things of scripture, did God mean for it to be this way? These struggles, these tribulations, did He mean for us just to wallow in it? Like the hog washed up, I always say? Or did He mean us to be victorious over it? I believe in a Savior that wants us to be victorious. If there's something you're struggling with and you want prayer and you want time to talk that over with one of the leaders or someone here, someone that, a friend, a brother, or sister in Christ to pray and to be with you, we encourage you in that. But we want you to find that freedom. The scripture said it. You know, to know the truth, that truth will indeed set you free, and I believe that with all my heart. No, we have just a couple of announcements and we'll pray.
I want to tell you about a couple of apps that I heard about this week. One was on Scroll up here before service this morning. The first app, though, came from my son, and he sent me several pictures this week of a little old man, elderly man, General Tire, that every single day puts up sticky notes in the south end of the plant in the restroom. He cleans the restroom. And he puts up Bible verses. And that's one form of an act. That's how we can spread God's word. He sent me one of them that he put up was, he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our own iniquities. And the punishment that brought us peace was upon him. And by his words we are healed. That comes from Isaiah 53:5. And he drew the little half moon at the bottom and the three crosses on it. The other app that I wanted to tell you about, it's this one right here. It's on, you can Google that. Just Google YouVersion, the Bible. And it's a free download. And it's a powerful application because you can set up a program to read the Bible in a year or whatever time frame you want. You can select whatever version of scripture you want, whether it be King James or NIV. And we are now on there. If you go to the upper left-hand corner, you see three little bars, and you click on that, there'll be a menu, and you just click Events, and Southwest Church, and some other churches will pop up, but you click on Southwest, and it gives you every bit of the sermon that Randy just preached, the sermon notes, the scripture, and you then can add notes to that, to the sermon. So we have apps all the way from sticky notes to electronic media and anything in between, and we're challenged to spread God's word and do it in any way, shape, or form. You check that out if you need help with that. Ron and Melinda can both help you with that. No Revelation study today, no Radiate today. The next Radiate is the one Sunday service, which is April 3rd, I believe we had up on the scroll earlier. Next week is the first of the month, so we'll have our benevolent dessert raffle, so bring an extra dollar or two for that. Soup Kitchen, next one is April 12th. There is a list up on the kitchen door back there if you can bring any of those items. And the next VBS meeting is April 17th. And that will be coming up soon. We need help and we need workers there. Stay after the service for the little ones. Our minister of all things egg, Mike Morgan, has been out there working so hard. And he's got it out there to prepare. So make sure you stay for let the little ones be a part of that. And we have three birthdays. I don't know, some will pass this past week, some coming up, but Leanne Ward, Millie Dedman, and Tammy's birthday is tomorrow. So.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you.
As we go from this place. In the name of Jesus Christ, we have great.